afternoon, everyone. It's here. Good afternoon. From your masks, you have really to shout. Good afternoon. My name is Marta Filizzola. I'm Dean of the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences here at Sinai. It is with great pride and joy that I welcome all of you to the 2021 lab coat ceremony for PhD students. The lab coats received today by our students and this ceremony represent the start of their journey in academic research and their professional training. The lab coat also carries with it an air of professionalism and authority, which students have the opportunity to develop and foster during their tenure with the program. Now more so than ever, we see the need for educated voices from the realm of scientific research to be a part of the collective conversation and to help steer and guide us in the direction we need to be headed in. I would be remiss if I did not also acknowledge the conditions and circumstances around this year's ceremony. While we are pleased to be able to celebrate in person amongst our on-campus community, we hope to be able to invite our family, friends, and loved ones join us today virtually back to campus to be able to celebrate with us in person in the near future. It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Eric Nessler, Dean for Academic and Scientific Affairs, Director of the Friedman Brain Institute and Nash Family Professor in the Fishberg Department of Neuroscience. Neuroscience. Dr. Nessler, please come forward.
Thank you, Dean Filizzola, and it's great to take my mask off. It's a great honor to welcome our first year PhD students and their families to this year's lab coat ceremony. And it is a particular joy for me to see everyone here, what I say IRL, my new favorite acronym, in real life. This is an amazing milestone for us. It also happens to be, I think, the first official ceremony of the newly renovated Goldworm Auditorium, work on which was completed February 2020. So we're finally using it. Yes. Now, of course, we're not back to the old normal. We're still wearing masks and struggling to overcome the COVID-19 pandemic. But in my view, perhaps this is the new normal, getting back to a productive, rewarding, enjoyable, socializing life in the face of a virus that is likely to be with us for many years. After all, the influenza virus is still with us 100 years after the 1918 pandemic, which, despite annual vaccinations, which began in the 1930s, still kills on the order of 30, 40, 50,000 people each year pre-pandemic. We need to learn how to live and thrive despite the presence of COVID-19. And this is, of course, all the more possible because of the spectacularly safe and effective vaccines developed in record time, and vaccines that are far more effective than the best flu vaccines. Now, in the interest of carrying on in the spirit of the day, this is all I'm going to say about COVID-19. I think that also deserves a round of applause. And focus my remarks today instead on why you're here. Pursuing a PhD degree, a Doctor of Philosophy in Biomedical Sciences or Neuroscience. We hold this lab coat ceremony. It's one of the few in the country that do so, because of the crucial importance of the nation's biomedical research enterprise to our health and economy, and the unique responsibility that each of you will take on once you complete your training. Have any of you ever wondered why you are working toward a Doctor of Philosophy? I received my PhD in 1982, long before all y'all were born, and my research focused on the role of protein phosphorylation in the nervous system. I took only one college course in philosophy, but enough to know that what I did for my PhD had absolutely nothing to do with philosophy. Rather, my work, like most of yours, is empirical research in which we formulate hypotheses, test them experimentally with wet or computational approaches, revise our hypotheses, and so on. This is not today's philosophy. The word philosophy is derived from the Greek philosophia, or love of wisdom, and concerns itself as a discipline in modern times with fundamental questions of our humanity, especially the nature and meaning of our existence. Why then, all across the world, do scientists receive doctors of philosophy? I was always curious about this, so in preparation for today's remarks, I actually did some research, which I'll share with you. The ancient Greeks and Romans used the term philosophy far more broadly than we do today to encompass all knowledge, including physics and biology, which described their natural world. And this broad view of philosophy stuck for many centuries. As just one example, Isaac Newton's classic work on motion and gravity was entitled Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, published in 1687. Another interesting historical perspective is that through the Middle Ages, scholars in Europe received Bachelor of Arts degrees after 3 to 5 years of study, very similar to the way we do things today, then were advanced to a Master of Arts after 7 years of study. Most individuals, even those who spent their entire lives in the academic world, did not advance further. Isaac Newton, for example, never advanced past a master's degree. Doctorates would only be given on rare occasions, especially to senior figures based more on reputation than any body of scholarly work, more akin to our use of honorary degrees today. The first such PhD was conferred in 1150 by the University of Paris. The evolution of PhD degrees to denote substantive original scholarship didn't occur until the early 19th century, a little over 200 years ago, arising primarily in Germany, when PhDs were first awarded for advanced work across areas of inquiry as diverse as arts, history, science, and mathematics, retaining that early Greek notion of natural philosophy, encompassing all knowledge. This new convention caught on in other countries, in the US in particular, which in those early days sent many of its best scholars to Germany for PhD degrees. By the mid-19th century, the PhD degree itself was imported to the US, with the first American PhD degree awarded in 1861 in physics by Yale University. The practice was quickly adopted by Harvard, of course, then across the US, and eventually back to Europe and elsewhere. Today, the PhD, some UK schools give DPhils instead of a PhD, is awarded across all disciplines, across all 6 inhabited continents. Now, we know that distinguished traditions of advanced learning existed across the globe, particularly in Asia, over many centuries, but today's conventions in higher education practiced universally are based on these European and American roots. One final observation. Today, all fields use the PhD with very few exceptions, most notably theology, medicine, and law, which give their own doctor degrees. This too derives from history. The universities of medieval Europe were divided into 4 faculties, a faculty of theology, faculty of medicine, faculty of law, and faculty of arts. The first 3, theology, medicine, and law, were called the higher faculties, much more prestigious, and the faculty of arts, which included the sciences, were considered less prestigious. This was just based on prejudices of the times. It's interesting that by the turn of the 19th century, theology, medicine, and law were far less scholarly. Training was more in the form of apprenticeships and practical knowledge, essentially representing guilds, a tradition that continues to this day. Just by comparison, the rigor in your graduate school courses will be far greater than the rigor in medical school courses. In contrast, the study of everything else, in contrast to theology, medicine, and law, grew with tremendous depth and maturity. And faculty of arts became faculty of arts and sciences again around the early 1800s. And that for well more than a century, PhDs have played the dominant role across all scientific inquiry. And I'll just give you one example. Most winners of the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine are PhDs, as are, of course, virtually all winners in other disciplines. So despite the curious name that we have for our degrees, we should all take tremendous pride in what a PhD represents today, in contrast to its more humble beginnings. In working toward your PhDs, you are at the pinnacle of advancing scientific knowledge, which is more important today than ever before as we seek to better understand, treat, and increasingly prevent disease. As you all embark on your graduate student careers, get yourselves into labs that enable you to reach your potential and make your lives productive and happy. I consider myself one of the luckiest people alive because every day I love going to work where I run a lab, get to work with young people like yourselves, and pursue science, my life's passion. I hope that each and every one of you use your PhDs for an equally rewarding and enjoyable career. Congratulations and thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nestler. I would also like to recognize and thank our alumni supporters who contributed to making this very special ceremony possible. Our deep appreciation also goes to the Mount Sinai Alumni Association for sponsoring the lab coats our students are about to receive. And I invite Dr. Alexis Colvin, Associate Dean for Alumni Affairs, to join us on stage. Dr. Colvin.
Good afternoon. Although we have been physically distant, the last 2 years have also brought the Mount Sinai alumni community closer. You have not just entered graduate school, but you have also joined a family of incredible alums from all over the country. I hope you take advantage of all of the opportunities to learn from them. For instance, our Alumni Connect mentorship program pairs alums with current graduate students and has nearly doubled in size over the past year. There are also weekly Alumni Connect small group meetings in which students meet virtually with a diverse range of alums to discuss their career paths and benefit from the wisdom of their experience. These sessions are truly invaluable. Before I close, I would just like to say how honored I am to be able to welcome you at the beginning of your graduate school journey and to let you know that I will also be here at the end to welcome you into our alumni community. Congratulations and best of luck.
Thank you, Dr. Colvin, for those words, and a big thank you again to our alumni community. It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sandra Mesur, Director of the Office for Women's Careers, Chair of the Committee on Special Awards and Title IX Coordinator. She is the founding director of the Mount Sinai Office for Women's Careers and was Associate Dean for Faculty Development. Dr. Mesur will introduce our keynote speaker. Dr. Mesur, please come forward.
Someone took away. Words are written down someplace, and we're about to find them. Thank you. Steve? I think so. Yes, definitely. Well, thank you for including me in this, and it's been wonderful to hear Dr. Nestler and Dr. Colvin start our wonderful event here. I was really delighted to be asked to introduce Dr. Ana Fernandez-Sesma, today's keynote speaker. Ana is professor of microbiology and professor of medicine in infectious diseases. But I have a special vantage point because over the last 30 years, I was extremely fortunate to be a witness as Dr. Fernandez-Sesma has gone from a smart, enthusiastic, and very curious young scientist, like all of you, to a highly valued and respected colleague who continues to be smart, enthusiastic, and very curious. As she honed her knowledge and skills, her path has been uniquely hers, paved with truly remarkable accomplishments and all of them have been done at Mount Sinai, but she'll tell you more about this herself. After earning her MS in Biological Sciences from the University of Salamanca in her native Spain in 1990, she came to Mount Sinai in 1991 and completed her PhD here in 1997 and has subsequently risen up the ladder to full professor. Her research program has been both prolific and has had great impact. Her laboratory's goal is to understand the mechanisms of immune evasion, used by dengue, influenza, HIV, and Zika to establish infections in humans. Therefore, of tremendous basic biological importance, translational, and public health significance, as we all know, especially in the current pandemic. Since 2015, Anna has consistently been one of the top five NIH-funded investigators in microbiology in all of US medical schools, and has the distinction of being the top ranked number one woman principal investigator in microbiology. From our social science colleagues, we have learned that the most creative approaches to tackling complex problems are achieved when we have a diverse team. And Anna's cutting-edge research exemplifies this. It is multidisciplinary, highly collaborative, in large part due to the exceptional consortium of established national, international investigators she has assembled under a program that's supported by the NIH. She exemplifies the collegial and collaborative culture that is the hallmark of research at Mount Sinai and which you will all be experiencing. Dr. Fernandez-Sesma has accomplished all this as an equal partner to another of our outstanding virologists, Adolfo Garcia Sastre. Their individual and collaborative research has strengthened each of them. In addition, her parenting skills and ability to juggle her professional and family lives has led to successfully launching two children into adulthood. And important to all of you, she is an example of a scientist who is also committed to educating and mentoring the next generation of scientists, work for which she's won several awards as both a teacher and a mentor. Anna has been directly involved with the training of graduate students and postdoctoral students, and with our outreach efforts through which we reach future students in our community through multiple programs. As a result, more than 70 students and trainees have been part of her lab. Back in Spain this year, she's not been forgotten. In fact, her hometown of Bejar has celebrated her as an illustrious citizen, and then her old university, Salamanca, which is the oldest university in Spain, has named her an outstanding alumni. And finally, she was named one of the top 10 Spanish female leaders abroad 2021 from the Association of Spanish Professional Women. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Anna Fernandez-Sesma, our keynote speaker.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sandy. Dr. Meisu is one of my mentors, so I am very, very honored that she actually introduced me. And of course, for me, it's a great honor and a privilege that I give you this keynote speech today, because this is really a journey that I would like to share with you, because I also embraced this journey 30 years ago, or almost 30 years ago. So same as all of you, I also began my journey. And my message to you is that no matter what roadblocks you or setbacks you may encounter, this is a journey that is worth pursuing. The most important thing is to make it your own. You have to carve your own path, and you have to make it work for you. So this year, more than ever, we realize the importance of science and scientific rigor, the situation that we are in, and the fast development of tools and means to ameliorate the burden of this pandemic are all thanks to science. And scientists like us putting our time and effort for the good of humanity. Do not forget that all the wonderful vaccines that we are so privileged to have available, not only for COVID-19, but for many other diseases, are the result of decades of fundamental scientific research. I say fundamental and not basic research, and I say because I strongly believe that science being done in all the laboratories is really fundamental for the advancement of translational research, big data analysis, and applied research. If it wasn't for scientists working for decades on messenger RNA technology and ways to protect it into vesicles for delivery into cells, we would not have had such wonderful vaccines, and certainly we would not have obtained them in months rather than years. The same goes for the decades of research into viral vectors for other vaccines, such as the adenoviral vectors and others. This shows how interconnected all the science disciplines really are, and how in the face of a catastrophic event, scientists are able to join forces and generate solutions. Also, these new discoveries will influence other fields besides infectious diseases, such as cancer and beyond. So with that in mind, you should be excited to begin your journey, realizing that nobody is an island in science and that we are all in this together. I took an unusual path for my journey. I made choices that others considered the wrong ones. For example, I stayed in the same place during my whole training, but I did what worked for me, for my family, and for my ability to enjoy life the way I wanted. You can have it all, but you actually need to make compromises. I left my country of birth to pursue a scientific career that I could have pursued in my own country, but I did it for love. Love for my husband that was joining Mount Sinai as a postdoctoral fellow, but also love for science and love and have this. I had this curiosity about new places and new opportunities. So I grew up in a small town and I was always very hungry for new experiences. So it was hard for me to get into a PhD program in a foreign country with little knowledge about the process. Remember, this was 1991. There was no internet. So I worked for 2 years as a volunteer to gain the knowledge and lab experience to be able to apply. It wasn't easy, and I made sacrifices since I made no money. And my husband was a postdoc. We could not afford to go out to dinner. So we ate at home and only went out to drinks. So also this was also before bed bugs were an issue in New York. So every Wednesday we would walk around the Upper East Side in search for furniture that people put in the sidewalk. So, but it was really like a way of living that we really enjoy every moment because it was making us enjoy the city because it was really something that you could only do in New York. So when I was accepted into the program, I couldn't be happier. And we were able to enjoy dinner outside every once in a while after that. So I have to say that I had a wonderful experience as a PhD student. I learned a lot and discovered new things every day, but I also failed many, many times. I made mistakes in the lab and I felt like a failure, but I surrounded myself with great people that lifted me up and helped me understand that failure and your ability to recover from it is part of the journey. One important thing for me was having good mentors. So I feel very fortunate to have had great mentors in my journey that taught me about virology, immunology, and also scientific rigor, but importantly, they believed in me. I also reminded myself every day of how fortunate I was. I was doing what I loved, research and living in a wonderful city like New York that offers so many things. On top of that, I had a wonderful partner that has been fundamental to keep me grounded and happy along the journey. We tackled the hurdles together, although at times it is hard to take scientific criticism from your own husband. So we had to learn how to what our boundaries were, and we made it work. So I am also a very optimistic person, and I try to always see the bright side. So I always say that I like Mondays, and that I like people that like Mondays, because it is always the beginning of a week, and many things will happen in that week. We will start a new exciting experiment, we will submit a manuscript, or give a lecture or attend a conference. This is what keeps me going, trying to always find the bright side of things. But one of the most important things about having a career in science is to learn how to accept rejection without taking it personally. Many of your ideas will be rejected. Some of your papers will be rejected. Your grants will be rejected, and it hurts. To this day, it still hurts because you put so much of yourself into it. But you have to learn how to pull yourself back up again and keep trying. Because of that, when your ideas are accepted and celebrated, your papers accepted and your grants funded, you feel extremely accomplished. So the main message I want to convey to you today is that there is no right or wrong path or journey. You define your own journey and you make it work for you. Anyone can be a mentor besides your thesis advisor, your lab mate, your roommate, any other faculty. So put on your lab coat, try to like all your Mondays, and surround yourself with people that believe in you, and you will have a fantastic journey.
Thank you, Dr. Sesma. I hope your words today inspire and help guide our students as they embark on their academic journey. The next part of this ceremony, the part many of you have been anxiously awaiting, will be the presentation of 2021 matriculating PhD classes and MD PhD students transitioning to research, with the lab coats as a symbolic induction into rigorous academic scientific training. The students will receive their lab coats from distinguished members of the graduate school faculty who exemplify outstanding graduate teaching and mentoring. It is my pleasure to introduce some of our distinguished directors of our multidisciplinary training areas who will be alternating in coaching the 2021 matriculating PhD classes. Please stand as I call your names. Dr. George Huntley, Director of Neuroscience Program. Dr. Doris Germain, Co-Director of Cancer Biology MTA. Dr. Florence Marlowe, Co-Director of Development, Regeneration and Stem Cell MTA. Dr. Jonathan Carr, Co-Director of Genetics and Genomic Sciences MTA. Dr. Jeremiah Faith and Dr. Costantina Alexandropoulos, Co-Directors of Immunology MTA. Dr. Domenico Tortorella and Dr. Jean Lim, co-directors of Microbiology MTA. Our co-directors for Pharmacology and Therapeutics Discovery MTA, Dr. Avner Schlesinger and Dr. Eric Sobi, as well as one of the co-directors for our newest Artificial Intelligence and Emerging Technology MTA, Dr. Alan Seifert. It is also my pleasure to introduce this year's roster reader for our doctoral studies, Dr. Matthew O'Connell, Senior Associate Dean for Curriculum, Recruitment and Admissions for the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences and Professor of Pharmacological Sciences. Dr. O'Connell.
Thank you, Dean Filizola. I'm going to do something I haven't done in a room with other people since March 2020. Brace yourself. There we go. So welcome, everybody, to the 2021 Matriculating PhD and MD PhD class. It's truly an honor to be a part of this, to be back here, and to be sharing this together. I will kindly ask those of you here in the audience to hold your applause until each group of four students comes up to be coated, and then they will return to their seats. I will be reading everybody's preferred name, which may differ slightly from what is in the program. Okay. And so now it's my pleasure to call up the 2021 matriculating PhD class, and I ask that our first four coaters take the stage. Matt, we're good to go? Okay, so here we go, our first group. We have Joanna Alvarez, Kailish Bapu Panaselvam, Austin Bagheta, and Jacqueline Beltran. Everybody. just keep smiling, everybody. Okay, continuing on. Tessia Bobrowski, Matthew Brown, Ariana Chris, and Anastasia Kupik. Okay, Gloria Dewodu, Lamberto Deboni, Tree Dong, and Rachel Fisher. Yeah, faculty step right, student step. Okay. You stay. Okay, continuing on, we have Anna Fortin-Juarez, Chizu Fu, Jacob Glickman, not you here, Alex Guzman Soles. That's our group of four. One person didn't come. Okay, that was a trick quiz, everybody. Get you ready for Friday. Okay, another group of three. We have Grace Jones, Tanvi Yoshi, and Hannah Cottrell. Our next three are Mariana Liang, Alexandra McGee, and Christina Ma. And many thanks to our first group of coaches. Thank you very much. Could our next group of coaches please come up on stage? All right. Okay, continuing on. Gayatri Manka, Maria Mercedes. Okay, Adriana Mendez and Paul Morgan. right, very good. Group of three. We have Alita Murphy, Trevor Murphy, and Motaz Nuruddin. Okay, Christy Oliemi, Alec Pankow, Nastine Param, and Dmitry Prokushilov. Levon Rodriguez, Giselle Roja, Bryce Rowan, and Magdalena Rutikowski. Ina Somanovic, Natalie Sui, Pierre Tollens, and Alyssa Valentin. Shruti Venkat, Anna Alessandro Nicoletta Cruz Yu, and Ihan Zhao. And so with that, I'd like to give my heartiest congratulations to the 2021 matriculating PhD students. Round of applause.
Thank you, Dr. Carnell. It is time to call on stage the Medical Scientist Training Program students who will be starting their research. Dr. Margaret Barron, Senior Associate Dean for MD-PhD Education, and Dr. Talia Schwartz, Associate Dean for MD-PhD Education, will read the names of the MD-PhD candidates. Dr. Barron and Schwartz, please come forward.
It's now time to call on stage the Medical Scientist Training Program students who will also be starting their research. We will call the MD-PhD students beginning their research in groups of two or three. I kindly ask those of you in the audience to hold your applause until after the group of two or three is complete. Will the following students in attendance today please come up on stage when we call your names?
Samuel Allen, Samantha Brown, Jacqueline Lee.
Chang Moon and Ariana Neal.
Key Josh Park, Karina Sia, OJ Stewart.
At this time, I ask that all students presented with a lab coat today stand and be applauded in your new lab coats.
Now I have the pleasure to present Dr. Basil Hans, Senior Associate Dean for Student Affairs and Associate Dean for Wellness, to administer the PhD oath followed by the faculty pledge. Dr. Hans.
Dr. Pilazzola, congratulations to everyone. Before we get to the oaths, I think it would be a good idea if all of those who were coded today stand up and give a nice round of applause to your family, loved ones, and others who helped support you through all of this. And they're on Zoom, so be loud. All right, congratulations, everyone. What a great day. I now would like to ask the PhD and MD PhD classes who were just coded to stand and join me in reciting our PhD oath. Before I begin reading the oath, I would like to invite all PhD doctoral candidates and PhDs in the audience and seated next to me on stage to stand so we may all together dedicate and rededicate our commitment to our profession. The oath is printed and displayed here. It's printed on page 8 of the booklet, and it's displayed up top too. Okay, with my Doctor of Philosophy, I willingly pledge to uphold the highest level of integrity, professionalism, scholarship, and honor. I will conduct my research and professional endeavors with honesty and objectivity. I will apply the highest standards of rigor and respect for the generation and application of knowledge, and fully acknowledge the contributions of others. I will not allow financial gain or ambition to cloud my judgment or decision-making, nor cause harm to society or subjects of research. I will embark on the furthering of knowledge through respectful interactions and collaborations with my colleagues and community, prejudice or exclusion. I will be a role model and use my skills to inspire, mentor, and empower future generations, instilling in them the highest principles of ethical behavior. As witnessed by all present today, and in the tradition of graduates before me, I do affirm to uphold the guiding principles. Congratulations, you can be seated. I now ask all faculty members of the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai to stand and join me in the faculty pledge. The pledge can be found on page 9 and it's also going to be displayed above. As teachers and mentors for our students, we pledge to maintain the highest professional standards in all of our interactions with students, patients, colleagues, and staff. We pledge our utmost effort to ensure that all components of the educational program for students will be of the highest quality. We will respect all students as individuals without regard to gender, race, national origin, religion, or sexual orientation. We will not tolerate anyone who manifests disrespect or expresses biased attitudes towards any student. We will not tolerate any abuse or exploitation of students. In an effort to nurture personal development, we pledge that students will have adequate time for reflection as well as personal and family obligations. In nurturing both the intellectual and professional development of our students, we will celebrate achievement of academic excellence and demonstration of the highest virtues of our profession.
I would like to thank the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences staff for their assistance today, and again, the Mount Sinai Alumni Association for their ongoing support. In particular, I would like to recognize the following individuals. Brett Gano, Associate Dean for Graduate School Administration, and his team, Matt Cipriano, Tiffany Cody, and Sarah Bryant. Without their dedication and hard work, this ceremony would have not been possible. So please, let's give them a big round of applause. All present are invited to attend the reception in the Aaron Hall courtyard across the street, but please remain seated until those on stage have exited the auditorium. And I also ask the PhD and MD-PhD students in their brand new lab coats to remain seated for group photos. The lab coat ceremony of the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences at Mount Sinai is now concluded. Thank you and congratulations to all.